In optimization, a great deal of simplification comes if the function is linear. And when it is not, the level of difficulty depends on the type of nonlinearity. And this is what we will analyze in this video. So we say that a function of Rn to R is linear if the function can be written as a linear combination of the variables. It means that it's actually the inner product between the vector C and the vector of decision variable. And C is a constant vector over n. So this is a linear function. For a function which is from Rn to Rm, so a function that takes n variables and provides m values, instead of using a vector C, we use a matrix A. So the function is written as A times x, and A in this case is a matrix of size m, so m rows, times n, so n columns. So the number of rows correspond to the number of values of f, and the number of columns of the matrix correspond to the number of variables of the function. A concept which is very close to linearity is the concept of affine function. Well, an affine function is a function which is a linear function shifted by a constant. And in the multidimensional case, we have the same. So we have f of x, which would be a of x, like before for the linear function, plus a vector b that shifts the value. So in this case, a again is a matrix, which is m by n, and b is a vector of size m. So such functions are called affine functions. But we have seen, when we talked about the transformations of an optimization problem, then when you add a constant to an objective function in optimization, it does not matter. Okay, so this additional term here, or this one, will actually not play any role if they appear in the objective function of the problem. So most of the time in optimization, we use the name linear even when we talk about affine functions. So it's some sort of an abuse of language, because these shifts that characterize affine functions do not play any role in the objective function of an optimization problem. Linear functions provide a great deal of simplification in optimization. But the set of nonlinear functions is very big, and you can have different types of nonlinear functions. So here I have plotted the graph of this function here, which is a nonlinear function. It's a polynomial of degree 2. And next to it, I have plotted the graph of another nonlinear function, which is the exponential of the cosine of the exponential of minus x. And from these plots, you can actually intuitively guess that it will be easier to deal with the function on the left as compared to the function on the right. Somehow, the function on the left is actually not far from being linear, at least visually speaking, while the function on the right is definitely not close to be linear. Okay, but this is just intuitive. How can we characterize the fact that a nonlinear function can be close to linearity or far from linearity? If we look at the two functions, we see that the slope of the function on the left is basically the same everywhere. And actually, this is something that we can think of as a characterization of close to linearity. Indeed, a linear function, the slope is the same everywhere. While on the function on the right, the slope of the function is changing a lot, and it becomes positive, negative, positive, negative very quickly. And this is a characterization of a very nonlinear function. So in order to characterize if a function is close to be linear or not, we will try to analyze how quickly its derivative is changing. And to do it formally, we will consider the concept of Lipschitz continuity of the gradient. So we will say that the gradient of f is Lipschitz continuous if there exists a constant that I denote capital M, which is such that the change of the gradient between x and y is bounded by the distance between x and y multiplied by this constant m. And actually m is called the Lipschitz constant. So now take the extreme case where m is very close to zero. Well, if m is actually equal to zero, it means that the gradient does not change at all. So this would be the linear case. In the case of a function which is nonlinear but very close to being linear, it will correspond to a small Lipschitz constant. If the function is highly nonlinear, like the example that we saw before, it will correspond to the very high Lipschitz constant. So somehow the Lipschitz constant is capturing the level of nonlinearity of our function f. So in this video, we have characterized what is a linear function, but we have also been able to measure the level of nonlinearity for functions which are not linear. In this course, we will treat linear and nonlinear optimization separately because the type of problems that we are dealing with in the algorithm is different.